Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming at this somewhat early hour. And welcome to the opening event of Neuroscience 2014. I'm Carol Mason, and I'm current president of the Society for Neuroscience. So I'm delighted to see so many of you here today. The meeting has an absolutely terrific lineup of great science, featured lectures by renowned speakers from inside and outside the field of neuroscience. And we're about to begin one of our really special events, Dialogues Between Neuroscience and Society. This event always promises, and I think it will deliver this meeting, to be the exciting and unique kickoff to the meeting. I'm also pleased to announce that as of this morning, and I'll be saying this at every day, our meeting registration is 29,310 registered attendees. As you entered the lecture hall, you may have seen staff handing out 3x5 cards. I encourage you to write questions on these cards and pass them back down the aisles. The staff will collect them. And after we have our speaker and special event, we will have four moderators who will ask questions, and they'll be standing at these mics in the aisles. First, I'd like to start by thanking Elsevier for its support of this lecture series that was created about 8 or 9 years ago to explore the ways in which neuroscience intersects with the world around us. So the intent of the series is to have experts from other fields, so none of our speakers are actually neuroscientists. They join us for a discussion on how, together, we can further understand the mind. The past topics have included meditation, the Dalai Lama appeared, architecture, computers, dance, economics, magic, mental illness, and art. So this year, we're very excited to discuss food and the brain. So I think you all know that with every aroma wafting out of the kitchen, to the vibrant colors we see on a plate, especially at restaurants, to the emotions surrounding the act of sharing a meal with others, these experiences as food unite us all. So the rich sensory experience that takes place every time we eat is made possible by the brain. The brain shapes our perception of taste and smell and seals the meal to memory. So it's a fairly serious, I'm not so sure how good, home cook I am and lover of food. I'm delighted to introduce our speaker, who is Chef Bryan Voltaggio. Many of you may know Bryan as a finalist on Top Chef, Season 6, and Top Chef Master, Season 5. Bryan was born and raised quite locally in Maryland and graduated from the Culinary Institute of America. After graduation, he worked in New York City, Paris, and Washington, D.C., for some of the most well-known chefs in the business. He currently owns 6 restaurants in the D.C., Maryland area, and all of which are on my must-try list next time I'm here, and I encourage you to list them on your must-try list, excuse me, including the Range Restaurant in Friendship Heights, which is here in D.C. In addition to Bryan's excellence in the kitchen, he's actually quite a passionate philanthropist, and he supports Share Our Strength, SOS, in their fight against childhood hunger. He's raised over $500,000 over the last 5 years to support innovative school breakfast programs and Meals for Achievement and the national No Kid Hungry campaign. I'm very pleased that Bryan will be able to join us today, and the title of his lecture is food for thought, tastes, aromas, and memories of food. Please join me in welcoming Bryan Voltaggio.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for coming by. We're going to have a little discussion on, you know, I was tasked with the idea of explaining what the chef thinks about when creating a dish and trying to evoke the senses and awaken the senses to hopefully create a pleasurable dining experience. I mean, that's always a goal when I get up and go to work, is to create a memorable experience and one that I feel that connects not only me to the diner, but then also maybe the diner to a place or a time or a memory. And I started to think that what knowledge do I have? I mean, what am I going to bring to the table here to a group of scientists like this, you know, who study this and probably already know some of the answers. But I started thinking, I built a small level of confidence. I started to think that, well, I'm good at what I do. I cook. You know, I'm the one who's out there touching and feeling and tasting and my palate. Hopefully, not that you don't know how to do that, because I assume that some of you know how to cook really well. But I feel like that there's something in there that I have that I can share that maybe will you know, take you out there into your field and maybe open you a new door, a new window into what we think. And then I started to build my confidence. Because this is the first time I've spoken to a group like this, I can tell you that. I had a conversation with my mother last night. I was like, do you know that your son is going to speak to thousands of scientists tomorrow morning? She was shocked, trust me. And so, you know, we started putting this together, and I got really excited because I think that there's a lot that goes on in our restaurants. There's a lot that we do, and a lot that we strive as chefs to try to connect somebody. And you know, for me personally, I've had a lot of food experiences. I mean, it's from childhood, you know, leading up to where I am now. And sometimes that's an easy way for me to reach back. You know, I want to, you know, going into the holiday season right now, I mean, I'm starting to think about, you know, mom's apple pie and pumpkin pie and what that smells like when it's baking in the oven. And there's a sensory experience that happens before I even taste it. You know, just the thought of knowing and seeing that pie, that beautiful pie that she bakes, and the aroma of the sweet spices and cinnamon and nutmeg as it's baking, and the anticipation of that happening gets me really, really excited before I even take that first bite. So the senses are beginning the experience with food far before it becomes sustenance. Before, you know, there's that anticipation of getting into something that you know is going to be really delicious, but then also, you know, fill you. And so, you know, I'm glad that Carol touched on the fact that, you know, I do a lot of work with No Kid Hungry and Share Our Strength. And, you know, there's obviously hunger is another feeling and approach. And I'm sure that, you know, the senses, I couldn't even imagine, you know, what a child goes through who is hungry, you know, what that feeling and emotion is like and what the senses and how the senses are affected by that. And obviously, nutrition is absolutely important. So I'm really glad. I just wanted to, you know, bring that thought up and just know that we're going to be talking about more about the luxury experience of food, but just knowing that we do a lot of work also to make sure that, you know, pure sustenance also occurs in every child, at least in our country. And that's what we try to do. So thank you for mentioning that, Carol. And so when we get into this, you know, we're going to talk about, you know, me as a chef and what I do with my team to try to take you to a place, to try to, you know, create an experience that, you know, evokes a memory. And I started thinking that, you know, food has is one of those pleasures in life that, you know, evoked by the senses, that awakened by the senses, can take you to a pleasurable space as long as we nail it. But there's very few other experiences, I think, that do that, to hit all the senses, all the major senses. I was coached into that because I know that there's many more beyond that. But as a chef, I feel like I focus on the ones that are at least important to me on the surface. And so I started to think more into that and that thought. And I had a couple of experiences that I thought of. You know, when I was you know, growing up as a kid, of course, I went to the beach. Well, I still go to the beach, but I mean, I'd go there and I'd like to surf and boogie board and do all of those cool things. And trust me, I've had plenty of experiences at the beach where, you know, a wave has crashed over me, my face has hit the sand underneath the water, it's filled with sand and water, goes in my mouth, I taste the salt water, and it's a traumatic experience, not a pleasurable one. But I feel like that sight, sound, taste, smell, and touch are all happening during that experience. And it's, you know, one that you certainly, you know, will resonate with you. But then there's also really great experiences when it comes to the beach. And you start thinking about, okay, well, I'm there at the beach, I'm having pina coladas, and, you know, we're going to crack some crabs and shuck some oysters. We're going to have a really great dining experience surrounded by friends. The sea breeze is coming in. There's the aroma of that. And then you get into the freshly steamed shellfish and, you know, the luxurious, you know, flavors and tastes and textures of an oyster. I mean, all of that takes you somewhere. But then if you have an experience and then maybe 5 years later you walk into my restaurant, if I can connect you to that, then I've done an amazing thing, and that's why I wake up every day. And so that's what I try to accomplish in the restaurant. If I can take you there through a taste or a texture or a smell or a sound, then I feel like I've accomplished something. And so it's a really exciting field that I get to be in. It's a really great, I guess, profession that I have. I mean, it's food. I'm a cook, you know. But if I can play to the senses and take somebody to a great experience that they've had and connect them, I'm excited and I feel good. So I try to do that. But then also, there's some cases too that I certainly find in my restaurant on a regular basis where people have an aversion to something, you know, they don't like. And one that always comes to mind in my restaurant, especially at Volt, is beets. I've had so many people tell me they hate beets. I'm sure there's probably a lot of people in this crowd that don't like beets. I don't know why you don't like beets. I love beets. Beets have like this unbelievable texture and flavor, and you know, you can do so many things when you can manipulate them into things to create new ideas or maybe change your mind about the beet and or maybe have it mimic something else. And so we currently have a dish on the menu right now that is very similar to, it's a play on vitella tonnato, which classically is cold veal served with tuna sauce. And so that seems kind of bland, but it's synonymous with Italian cuisine. It's really important. It's a really great classic dish, but it's very simple. And so we wanted to take that idea because I really enjoyed the simplicity of that, but then work with the idea of it and try to make it more complex. And so we look to beets to be that vehicle because we can create the meaty texture with the beet and present it in a different way. And so we do is we pressure cook them, we take them, smoke them, and then so that way obviously it has a smoke flavor. And I think that smoke, you know, we were talking about this earlier, smoke typically means that, you know, is synonymous with meat for some reason to me. I don't know. I mean, that's a personal thing, of course. But to me, it takes me back in the backyard and I'm grilling and there's an aroma of smoke and you're seeing the meat charring on the outside. Or it could be a mushroom or something like that if you don't eat meat. But to me, that's where that takes me. That's what I associate with. And so when I was creating this dish, I wanted to do that where the beet would have that texture and flavor and aroma. And the closest thing I could think of was that vegetable. And so when you eat this, it's not the same texture as a pickled beet or canned beet or something like that. And so I've had so many people come to us after they've experienced the beet dishes that we've done at the restaurant and say, wow, you've changed my mind about an ingredient that when I was a child, I hated it because my mother or father or somebody in my family pushed this stuff in front of me and told me I had to eat it and I was not going to get up from the dinner table. And I know that that's happened to everybody, at least with one or two or three or four ingredients. Mushrooms, I've heard avocado in the crowd maybe. Broccoli, which is what my brother, I used to laugh at him when I was a child. He used to sit at the table for hours. It would be hours on end. He'd be sitting there pushing stuff off his plate. And I have another small story about that, but he would be sitting there trying to fight the fact that he was not gonna sit there, he's gonna hold out, you know, until my mother even would be, you know, ready for bed herself, I would see. But then what he did as a chef, he created a dish to fight back broccoli, or to fight back at broccoli, I guess, I don't know. He created a dish that was broccoli, and he liked it, because he got to start from the beginning and build this dish and create something that he could relate to, and something that he could also not be intimidated by, and also something he felt comfortable with, because I think maybe because he was creating a dish. So, you know, there's a personal touch there, or something where he had a hand in the experience, and so he was able to get past his aversion of broccoli, and now likes it today. So this beet thing, I think, you know, also kind of did that. I mean, of course, people were, you know, at my, you know, it was, they're relying on me, you know, to do that, to change their mind about it. And I've been successful. But then also, just a small touch, when we're sitting at the dinner table too, I just recently learned this, that for some reason my mom always served peas, but she didn't like them. And I just learned this, as I'm 38 years old, and I just found this out 2 weeks ago, that she used to take peas and kick them off the plate too. So now I feel like it was not fair in our household, but that's okay. I learned to eat my vegetables, which is great, because I love the textures. You know, so these senses that we look to play off of in the restaurant are really, really important. You know, the first is the experience. I mean, when you're thinking about a restaurant, there's restaurants on many different levels. Okay, there's your fine dining, Uber, you know, 3-star Michelin experience, 21 course tasting menu, wine pairings, the whole nine yards, all of these things that are, you know, over the top, right? And then you have fast food, or what we like to call fast casual now, you know, is the new term that we like to use because it sounds better. Because we don't want our food fast. We want the thought to be that there's some care that goes into it. So I like the evolution of that. But the one thing that that everyone, I think, would realize, that there's also, and I'm not going to talk to the science too much because I'm not that good at it, but I will say that there's certainly some thoughts into how these venues are created. You know, when you're talking about fast food or fast casual, you think about bright colors, large noise sounds like mascots and this and that, and drive-through windows and hard surfaces. Well, that's created so you get in and get out, right? It's so there's a speed, you know, that's the element that those people in marketing and those ideas, you know, they use so that that way they can turn over quickly. That's not the experience we're trying to create in a fine dining restaurant. We want to try to create an experience where you feel comfortable, where you feel welcomed, you feel like you can loosen up, you can take off your tie, and or just, you know, kind of give yourself some relaxation. That's a part of the experience. It's not just a, you know, get up and go. But then there's things that fall in between. I have restaurants that follow in all of those three. Well, I'm not the hard surface drive-through window, but, you know, we created a fast casual experience, but we wanted to tie freshness into that. And so I feel like that we've done a really good job with that. But there's already, by the sight, when you walk in, and the ambiance and the sounds and the things that you touch, feel, and see and feel at the moment when you walk in, there's already an expectation. It's been set. Okay? Well, now, with obviously social media and everything else that goes on, I mean, you see half of my dishes before you even walk into my restaurant. So I'm also, you know, up against that too, which is challenging as a chef, because 15 years ago, we didn't have to do that. There was an element of surprise when you came into my restaurants and you sat down and we gave you that first serving. We're like, oh, that's what I saw on Yelp yesterday. Oh, yeah, I saw that already. You know what I mean? So that element's kind of been removed, and we have to fight that a little bit, you know, which is okay. It's a new challenge right now for us. But you also, you have a sense of what you're getting into. You come in, the candles are lit, the tablecloths are ironed, they're pressed, the uniforms look really, you know, well, hopefully they look better than mine. They look pressed and clean and ready to go. And so there's a level of expectation that's set. So when you come in, you don't go through a drive-through window to get a 10-course degustation menu with pairings, do you? No. So we create an experience as a restaurant group and restaurateurs and chefs so that we can fulfill our vision, you know, to take you to a comfortable spot, to get you in a place where you will also feel comfortable letting us do things for you, to serve you, to hopefully evoke those memories, to turn you on to a new idea, to maybe that you learn something. You see, you have a texture of a vegetable that we've manipulated in a great way that's unknown to you, and so it becomes fun and exciting and exhilarating and things that are new. And so, you know, that's what we tried to create, and that's where it starts. But then, you know, it also starts with what we do when we're procuring ingredients and we're looking at freshness. I mean, who's seen a rotten apple? Do you want to bite into that? No. You want that glistening apple, droplets of water on the outside. There's a feeling and a look of freshness also. Like, you can attach yourself and identify with the fact that that should taste good. Well, there's also some strawberries out there that look really great, but they don't taste like anything. You know, so as a chef, we're always looking for the next flavor, the next texture. We're also looking for things that are already out there right now in the market that should already taste good. You know, and sometimes that's a struggle because obviously things, you know, food has evolved and has changed and made to travel. You know, so we're obviously looking hyper, you know, local and close to us and making connections, because those connections with the whole experience is really important to us. So getting really tasty food before we even do anything to it is also part of the experience. So I just wanted to, you know, touch on that part. And then, you know, then it gets into the first serving. As we're creating a dish and we're trying to think about like what we're going to do, what we're going to accomplish, you know, with, there's going to be some volunteers that are going to come up and hopefully experience some of the, what we're talking about, is that we're going to play on the senses. You know, always as a chef, the first thing is, you know, even when it comes to fast casual and fast food, I mean, you know, hamburgers look really good on TV, right? Well, they do for a reason. And so you salivate and you get hungry and you want to go in there and try it, right? But also when we present a dish, you know, there's a thought about how we architecturally build it or whatever, or put it on a plate so it looks pleasing, so you want to dive into it. And then there's the sounds that could occur on a plate, whether it be, you know, the whole thing of the sizzling fajitas walking through the restaurant, which I don't do, but, you know, that can happen in a lot of places. But there's also like the searing of pans. A lot of my kitchens are open. You see what's happening. And so you're seeing the noise and the excitement of the chefs and everybody moving around quickly, and there's stuff to be seen. It's a part of the experience. You know, you're hearing the sizzling of the meats and the grilling of the vegetables and all of that stuff happening. And then there's the aroma and the smells. And it could be that there's, you know, flowers on the table. We actually think about that. We don't put flowers on the table intentionally, because if you're starting to smell the food and the wine and all of that stuff, we don't want that to take away. So if we use flowers, they don't have aroma. And then you get into what you touch, and then, you know, it's the linens, it's the silverware, it's the glassware, that puts you in a place, or it's the fast casual, or it's the hard surface, and you're like, okay, I need to get out of here and get home. But then hopefully in our restaurant, it's like you're feeling quality, you're seeing, you know, pieces of the restaurant that you wanna grasp onto, and so that gets you into a comfortable spot. And then we get into, you know, that first serving where you're touching the food, whether it be the silverware and you're cutting into it, and there's that texture of cutting into, let's say it's a piece of meat, and you're cutting into it, and there's something going on there. I mean, not only physically, but, you know, because you have to cut through it, but also you're part of the experience, so you feel like you're involved, but then also, you know, you're feeling the texture through that tool, and you know, you're hearing the cutting of it, and it's just, you know, for me, it's building the anticipation. And then you take that first bite, and then all kinds of other things happen, you know, where it's like, boom, you know, I took you back to the, you know, if it's a grilled piece of meat, took you back to your hanging out with your friends on a deck, out back of your house, or maybe you're this really great restaurant that had something that was similar, and it was a, you know, a first date or something, and I took you back to a place of memory. Or maybe it's, you know, maybe it's just a warm chocolate chip cookie and you're thinking about, you know, how those used to be baked in your house in the morning, and then you used to try to grab one and you get slapped in the hand because that's a childhood memory that's really important. You know, I try to take my own experiences and try to take my food and do that, and try to create dishes that I feel like they're representative of my experiences and my childhood memories. There's going to be some dishes that we're going to talk about now, but then there's also one dish that, you know, when we get into it, there's also the thought that, you know, there's some people who have aversions to food or you know, an allergy, or they might have a change in their thought about what they want to eat. Maybe it's because it's, you know, socially or something like that, or they've changed their diet for good reasons too. Maybe it's a health reason or something like that. And so I try to also try to mimic things that they might miss. And there's one thing that I want to share today that I feel like that we've really has been a fun experiment for us, you know, in our restaurants, where we found a way to connect somebody to something that they haven't had in a long time. And that's really cool, and something that we're excited and proud to have accomplished. You know, when I start with creating a dish, and we start looking at the ingredients, I also look at, you know, how do I take one ingredient, you know, that looks beautiful in the market. You know, I go to the market, we do a lot of shopping that way, and we get the pick of the produce, and we're looking at, okay, this beautiful fennel, it's glistening, all of those things, it's not the rotten apple, you know, I talked about earlier, you know, it doesn't look, so there's that first thing where we get excited about seeing this first of season. You know, seasons also too, when you think about spring, you know, right now we're in wintertime, it's cold, and it's there's a lot of things that are really exciting now, sweet spices and stews and, you know, comforting foods, but then also spring, you talk about green and peas and, you know, morel mushrooms and ramps and all of this stuff that looks and signifies a season, you know, here in the Mid-Atlantic, at least for us. And so, you know, that's our inspiration, our first start. That's where we take that ingredient, and then we start looking at, okay, well, how can I apply this? How can I know what I know about the senses? How can I change the texture of this and create something that people are not used to? How do I make a piece of fennel crispy? Because, I mean, it's crispy with a crunch, you know, when you buy, you get, or you bite a, you know, bulb of fennel and there's that crispy crunch, but how do I make it, like, crispy, you know, or how do I make it luxurious, where it be, you know, in a puree form, or how do I, you know, just play on the fact that it already has really great texture, but then layering that, too, you know, creates a whole nother experience, because you're eating one ingredient, and you're going through it, and it's playing on all the senses, you know, because it's, you know, the smells, the aromas, but then also the texture of that can change, and then it changes your mind about what fennel is. And so that's also, you know, fun, because we have so many tools in our arsenal now as chefs that we're able to create these textures and manipulate food. I hate using the word manipulate, because, you know, to me that sounds bad, but I think we all understand what I'm trying to get at, is that, you know, how do I take it and present it to you in a new way? So when we're building things, certainly that's a part of the process, but then also it's, you know, creating food though too that is really good. I mean, now, like, again, I'm looking at the holidays, I'm looking at what, you know, what evokes, you know, what takes me back to my childhood. Again, I talked about mom's, you know, pumpkin pie earlier, but then also right now, you know, there's the sights and smells and sounds that are already around, and at least here in this area, there's a lot of things that are going on that make you start to think about food and make you start to think about traditions and make you start to think about maybe, you know, going back and seeing that old friend and, you know, sharing something that you normally have done in the past. And, you know, for me right now personally, it's, you know, it's about certain holidays and about gathering around food and about sharing it with people, but then also the smells, sights, and sounds, and taste and texture and touch, you know, of everything that's going to occur. And, you know, I build, you know, my menu around childhood memories and things that are exciting. So when I'm having, you know, dinner in my home, you know, I try to connect, you know, my family and build new traditions and try to, you know, go back and take a look at some of the things that we've done in the past and create those dishes and bring them back. So, you know, what we're going to do here next, you know, what I want to try to help do here is explain further with what I'm really good at. Talking is, I'm kind of good at it. What I'm really good at, though, is cooking. And so what I want to try to do here now is connect some of my thoughts and what I've been taking out of this experience and what, you know, I started to think about going into this, and also learn about myself as a cook and a chef. You know, what I've learned now about looking into how this affects my food and how I build a dish, and like what it actually means, and what I was subconsciously, you know, attaching to create an experience, I want to try to demonstrate a little bit here. So next we're going to do is we're going to get cooking. So I'm going to take the jacket off and put the apron on, which might be difficult. So in order to do that, as you can see, I'm going to have some people who are going to join us. Welcome.
Thanks.
So I'm going to introduce our panelists for the next section of the event. At the end is Barry Everett of Cambridge University, and he's one of our Society of Neuroscience counselors. Next we have Leslie Vossel. She's from Rockefeller University, and Stuart Feierstein from Columbia. So I'm going to
my seat. Thank you so much for doing this. So these four brave souls, just kidding, have agreed to, we wanted to share, how we think, through these dishes and hopefully maybe get some reaction and see if what we're trying to accomplish is actually works. But, this first particular dish right now, that Graham, I failed to introduce my corporate chef and also chef de cuisine at Volt for a very long time, 6 years, Graham Ritchie. This dish here in particular, Graham and I worked on, this was his thought. We wanted to create an experience with something that has been stripping away from people. I'm trying to be careful because I don't want to preface the whole thing because I feel like I'm giving it away. So I think that I'm not good at those types of experiments, I guess. So maybe I'll just talk little and just share much about putting it together. So what we have here is not as it appears. It's salsify and a really cool leaf that has an unbelievable flavor.
You see?
And just a small porcelain dish. What we're going to do is we're going to put a little sea salt on the top, some malt vinegar powder,
yes.
And then we're going to serve it. So you see the dish itself. It's meant to be picked up and eaten.
Ready? Ready to get there?
1, 2, 3, go.
1, 2, 3, go.
1, 2, 3.
Just like in college. There you go.
Mm.
So I have to clue in because normally when we're delivering this dish in a restaurant, we're giving them some more direction than I just did. We're explaining what we're trying to accomplish in the dish before we even give it to them. But what this dish was inspired from was the fact that my father-in-law at age 54 was not able to eat shellfish anymore. Loved shellfish. Love absolutely was. I would never see Jack Koval without shrimp in front of him. It was amazing. So he couldn't eat shellfish anymore. And so we started talking a little bit, Graham and I. We started talking about also the fact that there's a lot of people who have allergies, but also aversions of food, but never textually experienced an oyster before. And there's something magical about that. I don't know. I like it. I like the slithery sliminess. I know we were talking about that earlier, and I know that you have an aversion to those textures and one particular ingredient, but there's something that's exciting about that. There's something exciting about eating an oyster, and I feel like that somebody has been stripped away that experience. We wanted to try to give that back to them as best we could. So what this is, it's called mock oyster. And so it's salsify, also known as oyster root, that has a subtle flavor of oysters. But then we also have this oyster plant leaf that we placed over the top. That it has a crispy texture, but also it has a really deep flavor of oyster in the sea. And we just played like a small slide behind. It was like waves crashing. I don't know if you heard the sound, but the idea was that there would be some sound involved that would take you back to the beach and the oysters and shucking, because that's a part of the experience. A little malt vinegar powder for some acid, and that's the dish. We serve it in a dish that we took actual Blue Point oysters, the shells, the potter wrapped it around, and then took that clay and then fired that clay in the kiln so we'd have a shell that would resemble the oyster. Because even the oyster shell could be dangerous for somebody that couldn't eat it. So that's their first serving. So any thoughts on the flavor of that?
flavor is delicious. The texture is the weirdest thing I've ever put in my mouth. It's impossible. I have no idea how you did it. It's kind of magical.
I can explain.
Yes, how did you do it?
So I can explain. So, you know, there's chemistry involved sometimes that we tap into. So we took is calcium, nalgene. It's a derivative of seaweed. It's a powder form. As a chef, we could take that and hydrate it with water. We took the calcium and mixed that with the salsify, the puree, that we cooked down really well. And then when we place that into the bath of the algin, it creates a sphere around the outside, a thin membrane, all completely edible. I mean, but it's
just like an oyster.
Just like an oyster. Yeah. So when you bite into it, I wish I could have thousands for you to share and give it to everybody. When you bite, the idea is when you bite into it, you get that texture, that burst of flavor, that, you know, brininess with the salt on the top, and it's just supposed to mimic the texture of the oyster.
I mean, it's nothing like salsify.
It's nothing like salsify.
At all.
And you know oyster well in salsify.
Right.
Yeah, it's nothing like the original. I mean, so we took that and we created something new with it. But also, the thought process was to make it be something that it wasn't, you know. But playing on the flavor profile, that made it easy. But texturally, we had to change it in order to get to our point.
So I'd always thought it...
Sorry. Go ahead.
I'd always thought it was a rather brave soul that ate the first oyster.
Yes.
I can't really imagine who had that idea. But I recently learned to eat oysters without all the sauce on them, which is quite an exceptional experience, it turns out, because the whole sea is in there, and so much of that was in here. I appreciated not having the hot sauce or the red sauce or the other kind of sauce.
Yeah, it is. I mean, with this dish, we wanted it to be oyster in its pure form as close as we could get it. I mean, obviously it's not, but you know, the goal would be to try to connect you to that. You know, we could have put cocktail sauce on it, but I feel like I agree with you. I mean, oyster naked is better than oyster covered with sauce, because then you're just tasting the sauce.
Yeah.
To me, you know, we're talking about, you know, foods that are exhilarating, and I think that that's one of them. You know, that it's just because texturally it doesn't make sense. Why am I eating something that's, yeah. I don't like to use words when I'm feeding guests, but slimy and so forth, you know what I mean? Like, why is that good? But there's something to that, because, you know, it evokes emotion, and and texturally it's different than a lot of foods that are out there, of course.
Yeah, bad teeth slimy is very good.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
No, it's all right.
So next we're working on a dish, and this was a play, because sometimes we look to flavors as being, inspiration, and then manipulating them in different ways, and we change the visual look of a dish, you know, so that it doesn't resemble the original, I guess, is what we do. So I don't like to use the word deconstructed or anything like that, but, you know, sometimes that term is thrown around. What we do is we take something that's common and something that you normally see, it looks very approachable and comforting, and then we present it in a way that's a little bit more avant-garde or fine dining, but still try to give you all the same elements. We're ready to go. Let's try. Graham says it's time. So we try to give you all of the same elements of the dish, so that hopefully it takes you back to that morning that you had this for the first time.
And you should point out that you're using scientific equipment here, right?
Oh, yeah. Is that scientific equipment?
Of course,
yes.
Look at that. We have that stuff
Please,
in all of our
can
labs.
Can you explain to the audience what you have back there?
Oh, so I just look at that as a cooking vessel, but apparently this is a piece of equipment.
Yeah. So,
hopefully from one of our
You can't see it. Nah, that's fine. So what we have is you probably know what it is, immersion circulator.
It's a water bath.
It's a water bath. Yeah, so we're cooking sous vide, right? Everybody knows that term now, under vacuum. So what we're doing is we're cooking salmon so that we could get a certain texture. It's been cured lightly, so you might be able to figure out where I'm going with this dish once I give you a few more clues. And it's cured very lightly, and then we're cooking at a precise temperature of 60 degrees Celsius, because I want to have a certain texture, and a hot form is normally you would have cold. Is that giving you too many clues?
Probably.
Maybe it is. This one I think we could probably talk a little bit more about, because there's going to be some obvious things that are going to occur, okay? So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be creating salmon with bagels and cream cheese. So we have everything bagel as a flavor and texture. We have a salmon that's been cured lightly, but it's going to be served warm. Normally you would have salmon served cold. in this application. And we're also going to be serving it with cream cheese, which is going to be, for us, toasted yogurt. And what we're going to do is we're going to use a blowtorch because, you know, if we're going to have fire, let's have fire, smoke, and all of that stuff. And what we're going to do is we're going to torch the yogurt. Some would think that torching food has a flavor transfer. It's not. It's been proven. Propane is okay. See, when I have bagels and lox, I like a toasted bagel, and I like the texture and the flavor and the warm creaminess you get with the cream cheese as it warms from the toasted bagel, and that's what we're trying to do. I'm giving it away to you now. Start plating. So we have here, we just warmed the salmon. It has a really great texture at this point right now because it's fully cooked. It's been cooking for how long? How long do we drop that?
8 minutes.
So 8 minutes. So if anyone would think that you put salmon in an oven or, you know, on a grill or a saute pan or something like that for 8 minutes, it would be dry and overcooked. This is beautiful and luxurious, and you know the texture is going to be really great.
That was
also crumb.
Here you go.
And then the bagel crumb we did is we took bagels, toasted them, ground them, and took all of the spice you would have in an everything bagel, and then placed that into the bagel crumb mixture. So the flavors of the everything bagel are there. The textural crunch that you get from a toasted bagel is there. And then the last thing that we're missing is this. So using this thing that looks like an illegal piece of equipment, which it's not, I promise you.
Light it there if you don't want.
Oh, yeah. Should not torch it.
Oh, my God.
We have fire extinguishers.
Now you get what I'm talking
around.
About.
This is kind of spooky.
Yeah.
I like it.
So now I think you would be convinced that I'm trying to evoke.
That's awesome.
A few senses here.
Few senses.
Right. So obviously there's a lot of things that are going on here. One is, you know, you see a visual cue of what's to come. Oh, and you know, you see the fire in the background, the crackling of the fire. But then also the aroma too, because right now two of the guests, and we purposely did this with only two, they're already thinking about, okay, well, I've seen the smoke, I know what's coming. I'm sitting in the dining room next to the table who just got this dish. So they already have a preconceived notion about what they're supposed to get, you know, what this is going to be. Okay, they're gonna come here, they're gonna blow smoke in my face, and it's supposed to be smoked. So you already have a conclusion drawn, I believe, or hopefully, as to what you're going to get. But we haven't quite told you, well, I guess I gave it all to you. It's supposed to be bagels and lox, right? I mean, smoked salmon. But we also have to be conscious of that too in a restaurant, you know, that we're not giving too much away. And I think it's obvious here in this case, but we certainly think about that. So, you know, for us to be able to take this and smoke it a la minute in the dining room and do that, well, we made a little overboard because we need to make sure you in the back was able to see this. But certainly, you get the conclusion that you're supposed to be eating smoked salmon.
Oh my God.
Ooh. I would think.
Amazing.
And so we instantly were able to apply that flavor and smoke and aroma, and you see that, and you could connect to it visually because you see the smoke and it's a part of the experience. And you know, you lift that up, and there's something that's really special about that, because you're also feeling like you're participating in it almost. I mean, I think, you know, maybe not. I mean, that's the thought process when we're creating a dish like this. And this is a simple form of the dish that we normally do in a restaurant, and it's sort of a brunch version.
Bryan, this is a magnificent entry into smoked salmon, and then you get the creaminess of the... But the crumbs, I have to say, is an everything bagel.
It is?
It's an everything bagel. Yeah.
Well, I think we have one,
so it
one
has
that
all of
enjoyed it.
Can I lick all of the... I'll just lick the plate, can I?
So all of the flavor.
Thank you.
Those of you who don't...
That was the goal right there. I can drop the mic. I'm out of here. That's it. So, well, thank you. And so, you know, that's something that me personally, I really loved. I mean, I worked in New York for 6 years, and so I would go and get bagels and lox, you know, in the right spots, and I would get the really good ones, you know, and so that was my morning walk with a coffee, and I always liked that experience. I mean, it was something that you know, as a young cook, that I learned. I loved the textural changes, and I'm an everything bagel kind of guy, too. You know, like, I want some flavor. I want there to be impact. Yeah, I know, and garlic on the breath, but so what? I don't care, because I want something that tastes good. And so for me, that's my go-to. So
the only thing missing here is my mother hawking on me about why I'm not a real doctor. Otherwise, it's all here. I have to say.
Well, thank you. All right. Well, I can clear this one. And then...
Excellent.
That was good. It was a great sensory illusion, right? You tricked
it,
us.
It was, you right. know, well, it was illusion, but also, I mean,
well, but it's an essence, actually.
Yeah, yeah, I
essence.
Think that you, we connected too, because, you know, we took the bagel and lox. If I gave that to you, you'd be like, okay, well, that's what that is. If I didn't tell you everything, which I'm not doing a really good job of making my experiments here with you come through, but because I'm giving a lot away, so that way. That way it works. It's a little bit cheating, right? But you know, but the goal would be in a restaurant would be that I take you there. I take you to that your first bagel lox experience, and you know, you identify with what it is, and you know, in a simple way. And so we think about, like, okay, well, how can we do this? And you know, obviously we have tools that we're able to do that. Now we can bring these things into the dining room, and we can create something you can't do at home. You know, so we're always looking for that next thing in a kitchen where, you know, look, the goal is that we also make reservations too, right? I mean, I know everybody loves to cook at home when you get a chance, but if I don't give you an experience that's more than what you can already do, it's more than just sustenance, it's more than just a meal, more than just feeding yourself and, you know, something getting through the day, more than just that power bar or whatever you have at midday, so you can, you know, continue with your experiments and get through the rest of the day till happy hour. I need to make an experience that's more than what you're able to do yourself.
Well, of course, what was nice about this was, if I'd actually had a big bagel, everything bagel with a lump of cream cheese on it and a big hunk of salmon, I'd be done for the day.
Right.
Right now. Whereas now I've had that whole experience, but I'm ready for more food.
Ready for more.
Yes.
Now I got you hooked, because now you're hungry. But things are happening now too, because you know, there is also that point of, you know, where, you know, you're hungry. But then also, or you want to have an experience, but also there's that first bite that, you know, a meal is actually planned. You know, there's things that happen, you know, high acid in the beginning, low acid in the middle, you know, so that way we're evoking the palate, and we're awakening the taste buds, and we're, you know, bitters and things like that, you know, Campari and soda start out as an aperitif. And so there's a thought process and a plan also that we try to play off of, and how the body reacts in many different ways to what you're eating. And so there's a build up and an anticipation. There's a, you know, and then when you get into sweetness, obviously you feel like you're in a comfortable level of ending, you know, at dessert. But we also try to bridge those too. Like, if we're building a long menu, if we're building a 10-course menu, you know, we do desserts and things like that that start to subtly start to get sweet, so then way you get to the end and you climb.
So in some ways, without knowing it, I think you're sort of entering into this notion of satiety, which is very important in the sense of flavor, because your sense of flavor changes as you become more satiated. Yes. And that satiety can have to do with the, you know, feedback from your stomach as well as from your palate.
Well, it's also a point of no return, too, where it means, like, you know, where you're full and you're like, okay, well, now I have a discomfort. And so, you know, sometimes we also think about, like, okay, well, at that point, then, there, now, we start to implement, like, bitter experiences and citrus and things, you know, will hopefully help digestion. And, you know, so, well, that's a whole another, you know, and there is some thought when we're building it to create a longer experience, you know, with a menu, but in a short one, a 3 or 4 course, then, you know, it's about just maybe being playful, too.
But this is next dish forever.
This is still in my mouth.
It's lasting forever in a good way. It's not. It's not descending into nastiness. It's like it's retaining the everything bagel.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, thank you.
There's no off-taste.
I appreciate that one. No, because it could. Absolutely. I'm sorry.
So, do you like people to come into your restaurant hungry?
I'm sorry.
Or do you like people to come into your restaurant hungry? Because the hungrier you are, the less discriminating you are with the taste, and you're more likely to eat things.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Which are, you know, like broccoli?
Yes, no, absolutely. The thought of a guest arriving not hungry, you know, to me, because a part of what I do, there's a level of, for me personally, of hospitality. It's like I feel like that I'm giving somebody more than just the sensory experience, but then also, you know, the sustenance. You know, that they're reaching out to me to fulfill something that they have a void, and they need, you know, to fuel them for the rest of their evening or their day. And so there's part of that where I do want people to come hungry, but then also because I want them to get through the entire experience too, because I feel bad if they don't finish. But yes, I agree with exactly what you're talking about. That stuff aside, do I feel like they'd be discriminating with the ingredients? I mean, if they were not hungry, I would think so. I think at that point, a guest who might not be into trying something new would be less, you know, less encouraged to do that because they're not hungry. So I've never been asked that question directly. I'm certainly thinking about it now, and thank you for doing that, because I want to think about that more, because I feel like that at that point, maybe in the beginning of the meal, I should always have the things that maybe people don't normally like. And, you know, because I, you know, it's not that I want to give guests, you know, challenge of trying to get over a food that they don't enjoy, or maybe a flavor they're bored of or something like that, and present it in a new way, you know. But when I can do that, it's fun. You know, it is fun, but it's not my goal always.
It'd be interesting if you could, as soon as someone makes a reservation, they get a fact sheet. Do not brush your teeth more than 8 hours before coming. Don't chew gum. Have only 8 ounces of water, 6 hours, like a medical treatment, right? Make it very controlled experiment.
That makes it sound like a medical procedure.
Well, medical, but then a delicious meal.
You touch on something in two different ways that actually, you know, some of it pertains to here, but some of it's also personal preference. There's a lot of restaurants that do that. Not that extreme, but certainly give you a list of criteria and so forth and ask a lot about you, credit card information, blah, 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 what your likes and dislikes, which is also really good, because we do try to get a lot of that information in the beginning, so that way we can create a really great experience. But that would be fun to bring them in as a controlled group, you know, and start from scratch. So, this next one of my favorite forms of, well, let's do this. We're ready to go here. Let's Graham. Graham's going to assist me in serving. One of my favorite forms of table service, which is very, very classic, and you don't see it a lot in restaurants anymore, is the papillote. What it is, you know, it's basically a classic French term for, you know, cooking in a bag. And what we've done here is we've taken forest mushrooms and we've cooked them in parchment paper.
Wow.
And so, you know, what I feel like is
that
going on
here.
That
big bag had mushrooms at the
bottom.
I get a view of this.
Yeah, I'll take one over to the camera. Yeah, sorry, I'm going to interrupt.
No, no, let him take
It's working.
The president, you know.
So we have here is mushrooms, forest mushrooms, chanterelle mushrooms, cinnamon caps, some oysters, and some maitake mushrooms or hen of the woods that are, you know, local to us here. And, you know, it's fall. It's, you know, crackling of leaves when you're foraging for mushrooms, you're walking through the forest. The paper sort of represents that.
Yeah.
And then the aroma after you open that up, it takes you to that place because it has the smell of and what we have here.
Dreamy.
In the camera, sorry, the camera switches.
Walking through the
is
woods.
A porridge or a congee of rice that that has a beer and yeast emulsion, which yeast typically you only find, you know, as an ingredient in like breads and so forth. But I find that yeast has a really great aroma and flavor, and it's one that can be used in as an ingredient in sauces. And so, you know, this forced mushroom papillote dish is one that not only has this really great tableside presentation. Oh, you didn't get any. Oh, you did. Okay,
you did.
Great.
I assume we just.
But then also.
Spoon?
Sir?
Spoon?
This or?
Spoon, yes.
Spoon.
Spoon. But then also, you know, the crackling sound of the leaves. I'm trying to take you back to the forest. I mean, in a restaurant setting, I probably would have accomplished that a little bit more. There was leaves in the flashed up to the back of the screen, but you couldn't see
those. Oh, my goodness.
But the goal is to take you to an experience that I've had, you know, where I go into the forest in the fall and, you know, I do other things too. I hunt, I forage, I look for, you know, mushrooms and that's fun for me. It's peaceful. You know, it gives me time out of my busy day. It's something that I enjoy to do. So you're taking me to a place where I'm very comfortable. And I try to bring that into the restaurant and experience it, you know, with this, with also a comforting porridge. It's an oatmeal. It's not an oatmeal. Sorry, this is a rice porridge. But I had this idea when I originally came up with this dish that I was a child who used to take oatmeal in the morning and pour sugar and honey and everything over the top. And so my goal was to also then create a very savory, umami fueled, you know, congee or porridge or
it is like congee, right? I mean, flavored congee.
There's some citrus in here. Is there yuzu?
Yeah, there's a little lemon. So what we did is took beer, yeast, butter, toasted the yeast in the brown butter. It's good. It's really great nutty aroma of the
not
yeast. It smells and the thought is like fresh baked bread. And then yeast, obviously, is the ingredient in beer and in the fermentation process, you know, of the beer, and using that, those flavors that are in there to, you know, which adds also a little bit of citrus and a little bitterness too, which I like. I like to put subtle bitterness into it. So this is a very hoppy beer that we used. And then finish it with a little lemon just to brighten it and the acid. But the goal, you know, was to hopefully, you know, using sight and sound, you know, with the crackling of the bag, which, you know, in a very quiet setting in a restaurant, you know, cutting through that, you hear the crackling. It just, you know, reminded me of crackling of leaves of walking through the forest.
Can you tell us which mushrooms are included? They're beautiful and small, not your basic supermarket.
Oh. Yeah, so we used golden chanterelle mushrooms, hen of the woods, maitake mushrooms, which is another term for that, and then clamshell mushrooms. We're all the three that we use.
There's nothing I'm more afraid of or averse to than mushrooms.
Well, I was not giving that information before we started this.
It's delicious.
Really?
So.
Did you finish yours?
I'm almost done.
Okay.
I finished. There's nothing more I'm afraid of than porridge.
Ate all
oh, really?
Yeah.
And so you've.
You know, you would think I would have been given a list of this before we started. So.
No, you've got me through a porridge.
But I've gotten you over it.
Yeah, you have. You
okay.
Have. My mother would be very pleased.
This could easily be the most savory dish I've ever tasted.
Yeah.
I actually feel terrible for everybody sitting out there eating this dish in front of you because I'm really.
We have more to share. I just don't know if I have that many. No, that was you know the first goal of the dish, and then how do I bring it into the season too? And that's kind of like what we wanted to do.
It should be a way to freeze this and put it in the local supermarket.
I mean, again.
It's a shame. That's right. Fabulous.
So we'll clear this one. And so because we want to create the complete dining experience, then obviously if you were in the restaurant, you would already know what's coming next. So
glass of wine, I'm hoping.
Well, yeah. We can arrange. But then next you would be starting to, obviously this isn't perfectly mapped out, but you know, this is the next, obviously you'd be getting into something sweet. So you already know that, you know, going into this. You know, you're already thinking about what that's going to be. You might have already selected it off the menu, or maybe it's a menu that we're preparing. And so with that, you don't know what's coming, which you don't. So this is a dish that was inspired by a season, certainly, but then also a goal to make something look like nothing.
I have a question for the olfactory taste specialist here, which is that, do you think the taste buds actually get prepared or would prefer to have sweet after eating such a beautifully rich and savory dish? Is that known? Or?
Well, we're conditioned to expect it, at least in
Western
culture.
We're conditioned
to expect it. But certainly anticipation, once you see it, of course, you start salivating, you imagine what it will taste like. And then it comes close, and you smell it, and then you put it on the tongue, and then you're there.
Yeah, I would agree that you're expected to, you know, that you expect it to come, you know. And so, you know, as I explained earlier, sometimes we try to widen the gap a little bit, where we take you down to sweet. I don't want to take it down or go up. I mean, I don't know which way you want to look at it, because some really like sweetness and some don't like sweet desserts. So we try to, you know, maybe do some courses in between. They're not little intermezzos or just cheese or something like that, but, you know, a slightly savory dish that sort of bridges it. I like to take dessert and pastry and not use a lot of sugar. I like to use a lot of natural sugar too, meaning that, you know, it's you know, maybe it's not natural. Let me say other forms of sugar, let's say honey and that sort of thing, rather than just granulated white sugar or powdered sugar. So what we're doing here is we're creating textures of something, and get the bigger one.
So it's sort of curious about sweet, because certainly when I was a kid, and I'm suspecting many other people here, when they were kids, one of the things that looked good about being an adult was that you could decide to have dessert first.
Or you could eat nothing but
or
ice
nothing
cream
but desserts,
every day
right?
of your
and
life,
yet,
right?
I don't know. I don't do that. I'm guessing very few of us actually do that. But we could, and we don't, right? So there must be some reason that this order works, I guess. We try dessert first.
So a lot of times in a restaurant, the guest doesn't see this part of it. So you're already asking, what the heck is he doing over there? So you're seeing more into what our guests normally see. We don't do a lot of this table side. But what we're doing here is we're freezing some elements to a dish. Because their goal here is, and that's okay, because this is -300 degrees, so I'm sure you guys all know that. And we're utilizing a rapid way of freezing something so that we have different textures of this ingredient in an a la minute process, you know, because it's really difficult, you know, especially in a restaurant setting, to do something like this without being able to do it at the moment. There isn't a freezer that would create this texture, so we have to do it at the moment. But the goal of this dish is more visual. This is more about sight. And it also has to do with smells, but it has to do with a personal experience that I've had. And also the goal of mine to create something that also looked tasteless. And I associate that with colors. You know, I look at that as being white. I think white looks bland. I don't know why. To me, it does. I mean, it looks like something that has nothing. And maybe that's just me. But I think visually, it looks like it's flavorless. And so I wanted to use white only, but use flavors that were more deeper than that. And also flavors that are associated with vibrant colors. So that when you eat it, hopefully you identify with what they are, and you're like, wow, that's different, you know, that's a different way that I've ever experienced that particular ingredient. So one would say this maybe looks like snowball. So this Graham's quenelling, I'll finish it with this. Oops. I went a little overboard with that.
That are our fingers, I guess.
I like how you dipped your hands into the liquid nitrogen, yeah. Like every scientist.
Yeah.
None of us has any feelings on the tips of our fingers, right?
It's okay. Yeah. You're not allowed to do that in the lab, right?
We do it all the time.
Oh, you do? Yeah. Like, let's have some. I could see you guys all sitting around with a six-pack of beer. Let's have fun with liquid nitrogen. Well, we do that in a restaurant on a regular basis, so anytime you want to come over, it's fun. So this dish, I want to give it to you without describing it, I think is probably the best way of going about it, at least the flavors, and then just see what happens. But I will say that this dish was inspired by times where I was a young cook and I was shopping for my wife during the holiday season. You know, at places that sell scented candles, perfumes, you know, like Bath and Body Works or something like that, you know what I'm talking about, right? For some reason, they always pop up around the holidays. All of a sudden, they smell really good when you're walking by the mall and you're like, wow, it smells like cinnamon and sweet spice and all of these really great flavors and lavender and, you know, all of these aromas that you normally, for some reason, I only pay attention to. Or maybe it's because it's the only time I ever go to the mall or go shopping, is during the holidays, because if I don't show up to Christmas without gifts, I would be in trouble. What did you?
It's very off-putting because it's so white. It's so white. It's
yeah.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. It's so boring looking, you know, is the hopefully the goal.
Yeah.
But there's three flavors that are in there: coconut, lavender, and vanilla.
Really?
Yes.
Coconut,
so I've done this dish before. Some of you may have paid attention to, you know, Graham and I on TV. You might have already seen this dish before. But this is one dish that I really think plays to the senses as far as playing with them. And so you look at something that looks bland. You look at something that also looks like snow, you know, which is tasteless unless you put maple syrup on it or something, or God forbid you have the yellow one. But
do we pick this up? Or?
Don't worry, there's no yellow snow here.
I was afraid of that.
And then texturally too, you're having textures of this of ice cream or something that looks like a ball, but it's crunchy. You know, and then also a vacherin, which is classically something that always has, you know, a really great texture, which is basically a meringue with sugar. And that always has a crispy crunch done by dehydrating it at a very low temperature, so it stays bright white, but then it has this great crack to it. And so, but it looks soft when you look at it to me. Like that the tube, the stick that's there, the vacherin that you have in your hand right now. It looks soft, but it's crispy, you know.
And the lavender is shocking.
And the lavender comes through, which is something that's synonymous with bright, vibrant purple and blues and like, you know, something that, you know, signifies summer and spring. And then we're bringing it to this winter, you know, at least visually, it looks like winter to me.
But when combined sometimes with sugar, it actually tastes rather abhorrent, often like soap. But here, it tastes sparkling.
It tastes like the soap that I was shopping for.
Yes.
For my wife.
Not here.
And so this is a two-part dish. I mean, this is memory of me, you know, having an experience for somebody else and trying to put it into a plate. And that's where the first inspiration came from. When we started thinking about it at first, it was like, okay, well, I want to do all of these, you know, elements that I've experienced, you know, as, you know, in my personal life and bring it to a plate. But then I started to think of it more. I was like, there's such shocking aromas and flavors. How do we make them look like nothing? Like, how do we make it, how do we mask the flavor? How do we give the enjoyment, the excitement of putting that into your mouth? And you're like, boom, wow. Like, that's not what I expected. And so that was the second goal of this dish. And hopefully that's what we achieved.
It's outstanding.
Was it?
It's really amazing.
Thank you.
Really delicious.
Every possible texture, except for sandpaper, right, is in here.
Sandpaper.
Except for sandpaper. You can add that in next time.
I got another plate lick.
You can't do that with a beard, actually.
No.
You can. You just have to do it all day.
You would take some of it with you later, yes. So we have one last thing that's happening now. I mean, that's it for your four-course degustation menu for the afternoon. But that's certainly, hopefully what we set out to do was, and what we try to do in the restaurants on a daily basis is try to play off of these senses and try to build upon them to create experiences that, otherwise you normally couldn't have, in dining. There's a lot of people that accomplish it very, very well actually out there in what we do, and I feel like that we do it in some forms, here really well too, and hopefully that you agreed. I always ask the question when we're in the back, like, what if it doesn't work? Then I would be embarrassed and I would run away. But so hopefully it seems like we accomplished some of it.
Amazing.
Really amazing.
Are you doing one more?
Yes. Oh, well, no. The last one will be your gift in the end. So we'll take questions.
Okay.
We'll take questions next.
I'd like to thank you so much for your great words and your cooking, which unfortunately we got to enjoy, but the audience didn't. But now you have a chance to ask questions. So I'd like to take a moment to recognize and thank our moderators. And Bill and Daniel and Daniel Saltz. Bill Martin, who's again one of our counselors. Daniel Saltzman, who's here, and Carol Barnes. It's Carol. Station somewhere. And Carol Barnes is past president of the SFN, and Serena Dudek, who is this year's program chair. And they'll be at the aisles, and we'll, let's see, I can't see over there. Who's, is that Bill?
Or Serena.
That's Serena. Serena. Okay. Serena, would you like to begin?
Okay. I think some of us that...
I'm going to clear first.
From the neuroscientists in the crowd here. We have a question that was asked, do you use any special cooking vessels to achieve a particular flavor, specifically something like copper or stainless steel, something that actually is imparted onto the food? Is there anything that you're aware of?
That's very interesting. Consciously, at this point right now, I don't think we've created a dish like that. We have used natural, I hate to say natural because everything's, let me take that back. We've used, elements of stone, wood, but like stuff that we've harvested to really sell the fact that this is supposed to be, a dish that's, let's say, from the forest or whatever, from rock. I mean, it's inspired by nature, inspired by where the ingredients were harvested from. We've done things like that, I haven't done anything where the food is actually reacting with a metal or the dish that it's served in. Certainly something I want to explore. That's very interesting.
Great. Bill.
Yeah, so combining a couple of questions here, really fantastic questions that have come in, but around the theme of dish creation. So when you're creating a new dish, which element do you begin with? For example, do you consider the visual, the texture, mm-hmm. The taste, and then how do you put that in the context of a larger meal?
Yeah, no, certainly it also depends. So the creation of the dish starts, I think, with, in my mind, a couple of different factors. If it's the ingredient that's been, that we want to work with, then it's the ingredient itself, and it's like, how do I take that ingredient and apply a technique to it without manipulating the ingredient or removing integrity of the ingredient or making, over manipulating the ingredient so that it appears, where it's not great. If you take tomato and try to make it crispy, it's sometimes not the greatest way to do it. Or if you, turn something into puree and you totally just don't recognize the ingredient itself. But also it's about season too for me. Fortunately in the mid-Atlantic, there's a lot of visual cues that are out there. There's a lot of, opportunity for us to cook within the season, and so that's where I really get excited. I mean, it's about the overall experience of creating a dish.
Great.
Well, I guess I'll follow up on that theme with a question really about the creative process and about how mentally you create a dish in your head, in your imagination beforehand. And the question really was, can you mentally taste flavor combinations before you make the food, the final dish? How do you imagine food before you make it? In pictures, in tastes, in textures? What is the creative process like before you actually start doing things to ingredients?
Yeah, I will say personally, you know, associating flavors in my mind that I've had, you know, as long as they're kind of, you know, registered there, I don't know the proper way of explaining that, of course, but I've had so many food experiences, you know, that I feel like that I have a repertoire, I have stuff that's hidden back there that I know that I can bring back at any given moment. I know what a lemon and arugula taste like together, and it's exciting to me. The pepperiness, the bitterness of the arugula, compound with the fact that, you know, this acid sort of, invigorates that. I enjoy it, and so I know I'm comfortable knowing that they go together. But implementing something else into that, you know, where I haven't experimented with it before, I can't never necessarily connect it and come to the conclusion of what it's going to taste like, and then that's where I get down to work.
Do you have any great failures?
Oh, yeah.
Good.
I fail all the time. I mean, some of the greatest things come from failures, though, too. And I think we all can associate with that. The fact that, you know, sometimes a food experiment gone wrong turns into something that's really, really delicious. I don't know when it readily comes available, you know, or readily available to explain. But I know in our kitchens, we've had things that have evolved into dishes. Maybe it's a subtle point of something. We've burnt things and now we're using it on plates. That's a really good example. All of a sudden there's ash everywhere. Well, you know, we've burnt leeks before and we've used the tops of leeks to create now flavors. And there's a really great acid that comes from something that's been, you know, burnt. And, but also it has a visual cue too, which is really cool. So, I've had that.
Good, Carol.
So I'm over here. Hi. You know that taste changes with age. Do you modify dishes for different age groups? And if you do, how so? And I'm going to combine it with another question. Memories of evoked experiences of food may change by your national origin. Do you ever experience surprises or get surprises from people who are from different places?
Places of origin with food? Sorry.
People,
sorry, I was missing part of
so,
it.
So what's your experience? Have you gotten any unexpected responses from people to food because of they came from someplace other than, the Eastern United States? And the first one was really taste changes with age. Do you modify your foods for people of different age groups?
Okay. Well, the second part of the question, do I modify food because of age, and taste changes with age, and obviously you're pre-programmed, right? You know, and when you're born with, you know, some things, and I don't understand that, but what I do know is that I have a 7-year-old, a 3-year-old, and an 18-month-old, and I do know in my household, I have experiments that go all day long trying to feed my children. and so I learn a lot from that, and, you know, I'm one of those because I'm a chef, and I always try to feed my children, you know, what I think is very healthy, and sometimes, you know, some would say more obscure stuff. But then, for some reason, my son still gravitates towards chicken fingers and French fries. but you know, what I do know is that in a restaurant, certainly, because I have many different, I have fast casual restaurants, I have family meal, which I think is the one where I have to experiment with age on multiple levels within the restaurant. I think that's my best example. So this restaurant is my answer, a chef-driven concept, to an answer to the American diner in a modern time. It's like a, you know, where we take wholesome food and recognizable, like comforting things like meatloaf and mashed potatoes and fried chicken and you know, all day breakfast and that, and do it with, you know, where we take our philosophy with really great ingredients and technique and execute that. And so I have children who sit down, I have, you know, people my age, and then I have people who you know, who are older and elderly, who can recognize that food very quickly. And also, I want to take them back to a place where they've had that perfect meatloaf and mashed potatoes from a long time ago. But then also, I need to play on the fact that I need to have that dish also be tasty for the entire family. So yes, there's certainly thought in building a dish that we're going to try to accomplish that on many levels. That's the one I think that where we have the hardest time, not hardest time, let me take that back, the most challenging restaurant for us from a menu perspective to accomplish that. Certainly, we think about that often. And then I don't know if I heard the first part of the question really well, but I'll talk to what I think I heard was, does my...
have you had surprising experiences, with foreign guests?
Right, traveling. Yes. I mean, I spent a lot of time, in traveling overseas, and I've had some very surprising experiences. One in particular I had in a restaurant. Actually, Graham was with me. He's had this before. And, you know, insects are a big, culturally, and in some areas of the world, a really great food source. And so I've never experienced it, though, in an avant-garde restaurant that's, you know, working at a level to have these types of experiences. And I was given an ant. It was kind of like a play on ants on a log, but it was ants, and you would take a carrot stick, and it was a brilliant chef in Copenhagen, and you would take it and eat it with this dip of creme fraiche with live ants that were poured over it. And when you eat the ants, they taste like lemongrass. Because what's been known is that flavor anteaters don't like in the Amazon, and that's where these ants come from. So it's a defense mechanism of the ant, but somehow the same chemistry of this flavor is the same thing you would find in lemongrass. And to me, it was lemongrass. It wasn't an ant that was running around my mouth. It was amazing, you know, experience. So I've certainly have experienced many things, in my travels that have changed my mind about food.
And moving lemongrass didn't trouble you?
Moving lemongrass, running lemongrass with multiple legs.
Crawling lemongrass.
Is not troublesome yet, no.
Is this turned on? I've been at restaurants that have served things like that to me, ant larvae or bull semen tempura, but they've always chosen not to tell me before they served it. They wanted my reaction first. So what, can we turn insects into broccoli and get everyone to eat it, or is there a limit here?
Okay. Yeah, certainly there's definitely times where we never hold back on describing what it is, because I feel like that it's also kind of taken away from the experience. I mean, we try to do it here. I haven't served bull semen fried, though. That's a new one to me. But what I will say is that we certainly like there to be a level of shock, you know, of course. I mean, there is some shock value. We don't play to that all the time, but we definitely want excitement in the dining experience. Me personally, I've had plenty of times I've eaten live things. You know, I've had squid, I've had shrimp, I've had, you know, many other things. And so there, that's a crazy experience, you know, already. And so, and it's fun and all of that stuff. It sounds crazy, it sounds morbid, but you know, it is. It's fun. We like that because it's exhilarating. You know, but there's some things that seem obscure, but then to others, you know, that's in other cultures, that's food that has protein and reason to be there. And so, you know, for us, we just try to make everything taste delicious. I don't know if I answered that properly, but hey.
So I think we have time for one more round of questions. So Serena?
Okay. Retail stores and some food vendors have long used fragrances to get people in the door.
Yes.
Cinnamon rolls in malls.
Absolutely.
And on the flip side, are there any foods that you know repel customers that you avoid in your restaurant?
Yes. I think we all know that around lunchtime, if you drive down the street and there's a lot of those fast food restaurants, somehow they can pump the smell of grilling hamburgers out into the atmosphere. I don't know how they do it, but it's pretty amazing. Or maybe it's just because everybody's always hungry at noon and you attach onto that. But yes, walking by, cinnamon rolls baking, and all of those things, you know, really great marketing is used, obviously, to draw people in. Smells that don't smell good, I've never seen anybody purposely do that. Because I would think that would probably be, you know, not the smartest thing to do, but I certainly would see where there would be opportunity to, you know, where that could actually happen without doing it on purpose. I mean,
purposely avoid.
Oh, purposely avoid.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Are there foods
that's
that
an easier
you do?
Question to answer. You know, there's. You know, I don't know if I want to talk about the obvious ones. I mean, certainly when you're creating a restaurant experience and a retail experience, I mean, you definitely don't want, there's a lot of them we could actually talk about. It. You don't want chemical smells. You don't want soap. I mean, if you're cleaning things. You know, we actually consciously think about that at Volt because our kitchen is so open. Let me kind of go at it a different way and say that we think about when it's time to clean our restaurant. We have people who are sitting from me cooking right here to you in our restaurant on a daily basis. So we don't scrub down and put, you know, chemicals to clean the restaurant because it's still warm, and so the chemicals will create smells in the restaurant. And so we wait to do that, or whether it be, I don't know, I mean, there's really nothing else other than that we think about. But we do that because we don't want the last thing that you take with us was the lemony scent of whatever, you know, that we're using to clean our stoves. So we certainly think about that as being a part of the experience. We consciously did that. It was probably one of the first ones. I mean, it was the first restaurant that I had that was that intimate with our guests. And we were there the first night. I mean, Graham was with me when we opened the restaurant, and we're scrubbing down, and people were looking at us, and we're like, and then we're smelling the aroma. And we can buy unscented stuff and get the job done too, but we realized at that moment we had to change what we did.
Great.
So yes.
We'll go to Bill next. Yes.
So you spoke a lot about taking people back to a place, to a mm-hmm. memory. There's been a lot in the neuroscience community around how music can impact memory and sort of evoke memory and in fact sort of emotional stability in the setting of emotional lability. Mm-hmm. So a sort of general question here around, do you think about the therapeutic effects of food? So is that something that you approach, and can you imagine this sort of in a future context of personalized medicine where there are personalized tastes and you can imagine creating dishes that take people back to specific memories?
Yeah. No, you know, I haven't consciously, you know, or you know, I haven't executed a dish where I felt like, you know, I was not curing or you know, changing an element or something like that, you know, where it's therapeutic. I mean, you know, I think that for me, just my first thought is if I can take somebody to a warm place, a place where they feel comfortable, a safe place, like a, you know, and childhood is always the one everybody goes to, but maybe it was last week. You know, maybe it was, you know, like I said earlier, that first date, it was really exciting, and this is their second date, but there's a reminder of that food, you know, that they had there. And I never always get the feedback, you know, so I'm doing this blind. But I try to use my own memories and things that are kind of commonplace and are kind of out there, and we play with those first. But then I also try to tell some personal experiences, because every once in a while, somebody will come to me and they'll share the same experience, because everybody's had them. I mean, there's so many of us out there that everybody's had a similar experience to me. And so every once in a while I get that, and that's pretty cool. Yeah.
That's great, thank you.
Good. Daniel.
This is an interesting question. You know, eating, of course, is a very active experience, and obviously you put a great deal of effort into how you prepare the dish and all the different elements of it, but the activity of eating can vary. Where you place the food in your, can impact the taste. Where you place the food in your mouth, how long you chew for, how long you move it around. Have you contemplated designing dishes that would actually interact with the diner in an interesting way that would give them a taste mm-hmm. experience by virtue of your instructions on how to eat that dish?
Yes. I can go back to when I was a chef at Charlie Palmer Steak here in Washington, D.C., and this is going to be kind of long-winded because it's a really good subject for me, and it's one that I'm always excited about, is I was a chef of a steakhouse, and I didn't understand how somebody could eat 18 ounces of ribeye and be happy with eating the whole thing through without changing in flavor. just seems redundant and bored and boring to me. I like, when I go out to eat, I order the menu. Like, I want to have this and that, and that. You know, I want to try all of these different experiences and flavors and stuff like that. So naturally, I'm always looking for that. And so we just served it simply with a tray of mustards, five different flavors of mustard. So that way, when you're eating through it, you can change the flavor of it and have a different experience, violet mustard, green peppercorn, this and that. And so that was my first, you know, this is, I was a young chef at the time and not a lot of experience, but that was my, certainly my first time I thought about that, you know, how do I take something that's boring and give, make it more exciting? Absolutely, we create and construct dishes, that way when you're eating through it, you have a different experience, you know, as it's occurring. Even with the coconut, lavender, and vanilla, because the flavors are so intense, I believe that you can kind of create your own flavor profiles, even though you can't visually see what it is. It's actually kind of fun that way, because then you have coconut and lavender, and then you have vanilla and the lavender, and you have the coconut and vanilla. I mean, I just, I think I repeated that, but yeah. I feel like that it's a different experience as you're kind of eating through the dish, which is fun if you're paying attention to the subtle nuances of, like, you know, what those flavors are, and you're connecting the two together, then it makes it more interesting. You know, it really does. And we always try to do that. If we can take a dish, some dishes are really good in one bite and boom, that's it, it's done. And that's what we want. And some of them, we want them to evolve as they're eating it.
Great. Okay, Carol.
This may not be fair because you probably don't have one meal, but can you describe the tastes of the best meal that you think you've eaten? And can you layer on top of that whether you think wine or alcohol actually enhances or detracts from the taste experience?
The best meal experience I've personally
had?
Yes,
you've personally had.
That's difficult. I've had so many experiences with food. And I've never been able to pinpoint like what one was. Sometimes I'm always asked what my favorite dish is on the menu, and I avoid that question like always, because you know it's always my next one.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
It's my next dish. It's my next meal. It's my next bite. I'm maybe it's just, you know, it's who I am. I'm consciously looking for the next thing. Always still looking back at tradition and structure and flavor and playing off of that to create a dish, but certainly always looking for the next experience, and that's exciting to me. Mm-hmm. How alcohol in particular, I look at it as like beverage. I mean, because I just look at it as it's just the liquid is a vehicle for another flavor, okay? They can be done with or without the alcohol portion of it. We've certainly taken, dishes where we've you know, paired cocktails that are you know, non-alcoholic. We've paired dishes with wine, of course. But it's the other ingredients there and how they play off the flavors of the dish that's being eaten. And certainly, there's a roadmap for that. You know, classically, if you're just talking about wine with grapes, you know, every grape has its own characteristics that then can add counterbalance and or completely just connect with a dish. As a chef, I mean, again, it goes back to the earlier question about how I take two flavors and can we compute them before we've actually tried them. We do that first by knowing what we know about the particular ingredients, and then next it just comes down to trial and error and taste.
So, can I just say something very quickly about your attitude towards your best meal being the next one? I think that's exactly what every scientist in this room would say about their experiment. If you ask them what their best experiment was, they'll say,
on to
the next one, I hope.
Yeah.
So we share that.
Well, that's good to hear because, you know, food. You know, to me, it's not only a lifestyle; it's an experience. It's a passion. It's what I love to do. And you know, yeah, I have plenty of memories of really great things. But I think I have so many I can't take one and put it on a pedestal. You know, because everyone has its own special piece in my life and what it's done for me, whether it be to, you know, to inspire me to do something different, you know, or to inspire me to open up my eyes to a new idea, to a new culture and cuisine, to whatever it may be, or to actually literally ask me to travel to go get it. I've had that experience too.
But you never got a grant for a dish though, did you?
But I never got a grant, no.
Okay.
Actually, that's where we might have to start talking.
Yeah.
Not yet.
So that's great. I really want to thank you so much, Bryan, for appearing today and sharing your ideas of creativity, senses, and it was really a mind and body experience, especially for the panelists, who I also thank.
Okay, we got treated.
And we had a delicious repast.
I'm glad nobody else did.
And nobody else did. Sorry. No. But and thank the moderators also. So
thus thank you.
With our dialogue. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much.